cross is recognized everywhere as the symbol of Christianity. And that's because the cross is a visible reminder of Christ crucified. The message of true Christianity is Christ crucified, risen, and coming again. There are four parts to that: preaching Christ, preaching Him crucified, preaching Christ risen, and preaching Him coming again. Let's look today at what it means to preach Christ crucified.
Welcome to Bible Nook's worship service. Pastor David Reed has authored numerous books, served as a contributing editor of Dr. Walter Martin's Christian Research Journal, taught at Spurgeon's in London, and pastored Emmanuel Baptist Church in New Bedford, Massachusetts. He now provides these worship services for individuals at home, and free to use by small groups and churches.
Let's ask the Lord's blessing on our service. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the precious privilege of reading your word and sharing it with others. We thank you for the privilege of coming together as your people to hear your word and to lift our voices in praise to you. We thank you, Lord, for providing electronic means for those who aren't able to assemble with your people physically, but are able to assemble through these new means that you've provided. So we pray your blessing now on the remainder of this service and everyone who joins us. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's join together in singing praise to the Lord. The disciples asked our Lord Jesus to teach them how to pray. He gave them the Our Father prayer, the Lord's Prayer, and it teaches us too what our priorities should be as we pray for God's kingdom, for His will, and then for our own personal needs. Let's lift our voices together now in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. These live stream services are aimed at providing traditional worship services for believers who would not otherwise have them because they're confined to the home or because they don't have a nearby church that sings traditional hymns and preaches Bible messages. And our services are also aimed at reaching the world with messages proclaiming and upholding the gospel of Christ. After the live service on Sunday mornings, our messages remain online and continue to reach thousands of people across the country and even around the world. Mike in Missouri commented, "Jesus is King, every knee will bow." Brenda in California said to one of our messages, "Amen." Judy commented, "This is worth listening to every word." Robin in Texas said, "God is in control. Amen." Lance said, "Thank you for this message. I have been searching for clarity on this, and now I have it. Thanks be to God." If you are being blessed by these services, you can share in this gospel outreach by visiting BibleNook.com and clicking the donate button on the home page. Today's scripture reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, beginning in the 17th verse. "Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of no effect. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, 'I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent.' Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through wisdom did not know God, it pleased God through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. For Jews request a sign, and Greeks seek after wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, to the Jews a stumbling block, and to the Greeks foolishness. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For you see your calling, brethren, that not many wise according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God has chosen the foolish things of the world to put to shame the wise. And God has chosen the weak things of the world to put to shame the things which are mighty. And the base things of the world and the things which are despised, God has chosen. And the things which are not, to bring to nothing the things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence." May the Lord add his blessing to our reading of his word. Let's join together now in singing praise, "The Church's One Foundation."
By water and the word. sorrow pressed, by schisms rent asunder, by heresies distressed. Yet saints their watch are keeping, their cry goes up, how long? And soon the night of weeping shall be the morn of song. The church shall never perish, her dear Lord to defend, to guide, sustain, and cherish, is with her to the end. Though there be those that hate her, and false sons in her pale, against or foe or traitor, she ever shall prevail.
In toil and tribulation, and tumult of her war, she waits the consummation of peace forevermore, till with the vision glorious her longing eyes are blessed, and the great church victorious shall be the church at rest.
The cross is recognized everywhere as the symbol of Christianity, and that's because the cross is a visible reminder of Christ crucified. The message of true Christianity is Christ crucified, risen, and coming again. There are four parts to that: preaching Christ, preaching Him crucified, preaching Christ risen, and preaching Him coming again. Let's look today at what it means to preach Christ crucified. In brief, Christ crucified means that Christ died for our sins, and that God loves us so much that He sent His only begotten Son to die for us, that Jesus loves us so much that He died a horrible death and took our sins upon Himself to give us eternal life. The Old Testament prophesied in advance about Christ when it says in Isaiah chapter 53, "He was wounded for our transgressions, He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon Him, and by His stripes we are healed." This is the gospel that Paul and the other apostles preached. At 1 Corinthians 15, beginning with the first verse, Paul wrote, "Moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received, and in which you stand, by which also you are saved." So Paul was about to sum up the message that he preached. He continued, "For I delivered to you, first of all, that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins, according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried, and that He rose again the third day, according to the Scriptures." This is the gospel that Paul and the other apostles preached. But there were others back then in the first century, even in the churches, who were preaching a different gospel. And there are others today who preach a different gospel. At Galatians 1:6, Paul warned the Galatian church to watch out for a different gospel, which is not another, but there are some who trouble you and want to pervert the gospel of Christ. So when Paul went to Corinth, Greece, he adopted a plan of approach for the message that he would preach to them. At 1 Corinthians 2:2, Paul tells us what that plan was. He said, "I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified." Paul forced himself to stick to that basic gospel message, even though he knew that many of his listeners would not be happy with it. He said of 1 Corinthians 1:18, "The message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing." Why foolishness? Because a crucified Messiah is not what Paul's audience wanted or expected. The Hebrew word translated Messiah or Christ means anointed one. Israel's earlier kings, like King Saul and King David, were chosen by God through prophets who anointed their heads with olive oil. So they were anointed ones or messiahs. And those anointed messianic kings led armies to victory over Israel's enemies. So the Jews were expecting a messiah like earlier messiahs, a king who would expel the Roman occupation. They didn't understand that the Messiah would be crucified, even though that too was in the prophecies. A crucified Messiah was foolishness to them, because he didn't accomplish what they expected him to do, to lead them to military victory over the Roman occupation forces. Besides that, they viewed Jesus as cursed because he died on the cross. Galatians 3:13 says, "Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. For it is written, 'Cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree.'" The Jews didn't expect a crucified Messiah. They didn't want a crucified Messiah. At Galatians 5:11, Paul spoke of the offense of the cross. The offense of the cross. The Jews found the cross offensive. But Jesus is the Messiah the Jews should have expected. That's because the cross isn't the end of the story. Jesus rose from the dead, and he's coming again as a conquering king. Jesus does fulfill the Old Testament prophecies of a Messiah who is a mighty conquering king. Isaiah chapter 9 says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end, upon the throne of David and over his kingdom." Christ was crucified for our sins, but then he rose from the grave, and he's coming again as a conquering king like King David. The Old Testament foretold that the Messiah would die and would ascend through the clouds into heaven, into the presence of God the Father, before returning as that all-powerful king. Daniel chapter 7 says, "I was watching in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man coming with the clouds of heaven. And he came to the all Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. Then to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion, which shall not pass away, and his kingdom the one which shall not be destroyed." Jesus identified himself to the Jews as that Son of Man, but they didn't believe him. The prophecies at Psalm 22 and Isaiah 53 tell how the promised Messiah would die, but the Jews who wanted a conquering Messiah would not accept a crucified Messiah. When the Jews rejected the crucified Messiah Paul preached, he turned to the non-Jews, the Gentiles. At Acts 13:46, Paul told a Jewish audience, "It was necessary that the word of God should be spoken to you first, but since you reject it and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, behold, we turn to the Gentiles." But the Gentiles too had a problem. Their Greek culture valued intellectualism. The Greeks looked up to philosophers and scholarly public speakers. But the message Paul brought them was a simple message: Christ crucified, risen, and coming again. So he said in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 that Christ sent him to preach the gospel not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of no effect. So Paul did not make a display of his wisdom as a speaker, a skilled public speaker, a highly educated man, but instead he let the message about the cross reach the hearts of receptive listeners. And then Paul explained that the church would not be full of educated intellectuals. It would be as Jesus said in Matthew 11:25. At that time, Jesus declared, "I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and learned and revealed them to little children." Paul went on to elaborate on that same thought in his letter to the Corinthians. He wrote, "For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this age?" As Paul reviewed in his mind the membership of that Corinthian church he was writing to, he noted the absence of any philosophers, any intellectual scribes or writers, any disputers or skilled lawyers or debaters. The church was filled with ordinary people, not intellectuals. He went on to say to them, "Has not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through wisdom did not know God, it pleased God through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. For Jews request a sign, and Greeks seek after wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, to the Jews a stumbling block, and to the Greeks foolishness. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men." Yes, the message of Christ crucified failed to appeal to the national pride of the Jews or the intellectual pride of the Greeks. But ordinary people like you and me, people the intellectuals look down upon, people like us accepted Christ crucified. God called us to put the high and mighty to shame. Paul continued, "For you see your calling, brethren, that not many wise according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called, but God has chosen the foolish things of the world to put to shame the wise, and God has chosen the weak things of the world to put to shame the things which are mighty." We don't see the church full of Harvard graduates and professors and highly educated people, do we? The message of the cross is foolishness to them. And the Apostle Paul himself was highly educated, but he avoided making a display of that education. Instead, he wrote in the next chapter of his letter, "And I, brethren, when I came to you, did not come with excellence of speech or wisdom, declaring to you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified." Paul did not try to impress his audience with fancy words or impressive oratory, but rather with the spirit and power of God. Continuing, he said, "My speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of human wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not be in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. But the unbelieving Greeks in Paul's audience wanted to boast of their education, and the Jews wanted to boast of their Jewish lineage, their Jewish nationality. Even inside the Christian churches, there were Judaizers who wanted to keep people under the law of Moses, with all its requirements of circumcision, kosher diet, and so on. These Judaizers in the churches boasted over their being Jews. They wanted to boast about converting Gentiles to Judaism. But Paul told the Galatian church, "God forbid that I should boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world has been crucified to me and I to the world." The Judaizers made salvation dependent on keeping the law of Moses, and that would have made Christ's death on the cross of no effect. Paul showed the Judaizers to be wrong by preaching Christ crucified, and he ignored the Greek intellectuals by preaching Christ crucified. And so what about us today? How does preaching Christ crucified set us apart from others? Well, there are some who talk about Christ, but who deny that he was crucified. The Islamic holy book, the Quran, talks a lot about Jesus, but it denies that he was crucified. It says, and I quote, "They said in boast, 'We killed Jesus Christ, the son of Mary, the messenger of Allah.' But they killed him not, nor crucified him, but so it was made to appear to them." So the Quran says concerning Jesus that they killed him not, nor crucified him, but so it was made to appear. Muslims believe Christ was not crucified. Islam preaches a different Jesus, a Jesus who was just a prophet of God, not the Son of God, and a Jesus who was not crucified. They don't preach Christ crucified. Another group that talks a lot about Jesus but doesn't preach Christ crucified is the Jehovah's Witnesses. Their Watchtower magazines and books originally did feature illustrations of Jesus on the cross back in the 1800s and early 1900s. But then they changed their teaching to deny that Jesus died on the cross. And instead, they claim he was nailed to a straight vertical pole without a cross piece. Illustrations in their books and magazines show Jesus nailed with his hands above his head and a single nail that passes through both hands. But John 20:25 proves that false, because it says there were nails in the plural through Jesus' hands, not a single nail, but nails, one for each hand, as was needed to pin them to the opposite ends of the cross piece. Of course, we're not surprised the Muslims and Jehovah's Witnesses failed to preach Christ crucified, but there are also others today who are like the Judaizers and the Greek intellectuals Paul encountered in the first century. There are some churches that put their members back under the law of Moses. They require their church members to observe the Jewish holidays and to keep a special diet. That's like the Judaizers of Paul's day, in adding works and obedience to the law of Moses to Christ's work on the cross, as if our own works were necessary too in order to be truly saved. But we preach Christ crucified, the full and sufficient sacrifice for our sins. Besides such Judaizers in the churches, our modern world is much like the Greek culture Paul preached to. They see themselves as intellectually superior to people who believe the simple salvation message found in the Bible. A football player may write John 3:16 on his face, and a sportscaster may actually quote the passage. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." But like first century Greek culture Paul preached to, this world today views that as foolishness. "Is there really a God?" they say. They say everything around us came into existence millions of years ago through some cosmic Big Bang. They say life developed spontaneously in ancient oceans millions of years ago through a series of chemical accidents. They say we today are descended from some ape-like ancestors who evolved from fish that accidentally crawled out of the sea and managed to survive. They say belief in a creator is nonsense, foolishness. We still preach Christ crucified, but like the intellectual Greeks Paul preached to, our world today views our message as foolishness. Still we persist. But there are preachers and churches today who have become like the Greek intellectuals. They say we are not sinners. We are fine just the way we are. They no longer preach the need for a crucified Savior. They still preach about Jesus, but they view him as just a good teacher, a social activist, a community organizer who had some good ideas. In their teaching, burning fossil fuels might be a sin, but sex outside of marriage isn't a sin anymore. Everybody's doing it, so it must be okay. In their thinking, if you see yourself as a sinner, you just need more self-esteem, not a savior who died on a cross to take away your sins. That's how the intellectuals think today, and many churches have taken up that sort of thinking. They no longer talk about sin that leads to eternal punishment, even though Jesus said more about punishment after death than anyone else in the Bible. Yes, that's true. Jesus said more about punishment after death than anyone else in the Bible. But the churches don't like to talk about our need for a crucified Savior to save us from sin and eternal punishment. Instead, for them, Christianity is just a self-improvement program. For them, church should be entertaining and should make you feel better about yourself. They don't say outright that we don't need a crucified Savior, but their message leaves out the reason why Christ died on the cross, to save us from our sins, to save us from eternal punishment. But as we read earlier, the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Even though many churches have stopped preaching Christ crucified, others have kept the faith. And if our Lord returns tomorrow, he will find those of us who are still preaching Christ, crucified, risen, and coming again. And now what about you? Is the message of the cross foolishness to you? Or do you appreciate that the Son of God left his throne in heaven to suffer and die on the cross for you? Do you appreciate that he suffered so that you won't have to suffer eternal punishment for your sins? You can show your appreciation for Christ crucified by turning away from sin and turning to Jesus. Accept his death on the cross as meaningful for you, and he will add new meaning to your life and will give you eternal life. Turn to the crucified and risen Christ in your own private prayer, and he will answer that prayer in ways that you can't even imagine. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for sending your Son to be crucified, to die that horrible death on the cross, to save us from horror in our lives today and horror of eternal punishment. We thank you, Lord, for sending your Son to be Christ crucified. Help us, please, Lord, to appreciate what that means for each of us and to show our appreciation by giving our lives to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's join together now in singing, "This is My Father's World." Heavenly Father, we thank you for blessing us with this opportunity to take time away from the troubles of this world to focus on you and on your word. We thank you, Lord, for giving us the Bible and all the wonderful things it contains to help us know why we live, why we're here, and what our future holds. We thank you for these wonderful things and for the privilege of sharing these things with others. Please send us now out into the world with your gospel in our hearts and on our lips. In Jesus' name, amen. God be with you till we meet again.
God be with you till we meet again. By his counsel guide uphold you, with his sheep securely fold you. God be with you till we meet again. Till we meet, till we meet, till we meet at Jesus' feet. Till we meet.